Hello everyone and welcome back to my channel. This time we have a camera and it's the very first time that I'm on camera on YouTube. Before diving it into the tutorials, if you didn't do it yet, subscribe to my channel because I need help to grow it to reach more people and you will also find my video more easily. Let's dive in on the tutorial. We will add a circle. We can already set up the circle as we want, so we can rotate. Into the modifier tab, we add a screw modifier. So now you're not gonna see a lot because you applied the screw, but you didn't apply on the right axis. In order to see something happening, you need to apply on the Y axis. Into edit mode, you need to go into object, set origin. Origin to 3D cursor. Now, why to 3D cursor? Because the 3D cursor is here, so we're gonna move the pivot point to the 3D cursor. Increase the screwiness of our screw. After that, we need to create a second DNA strand, so we press Shift D and we duplicate our DNA strand. Then we press ESC and we rotate what we created so far. We press Shift A and we add a cylinder, should be fine. Empty plane axis. We add a array modifier, so an object offset. And guess what object we are gonna select? Our newly created controller. So, if I increase the amount now, nothing really changes. The first thing you're gonna see is that it's rotated 90 degrees, the copy. Why? Because we didn't apply the rotation. We press Ctrl A, apply rotation. Here comes the magic. If we move the null object, so I select the null object and I grab the null object on the Z axis, all those histions move up. And I rotate on the Z axis. So yeah, the only issue is that we need to find the perfect number because in one iteration, you don't really notice the problem, but in more than one, you notice. So what we have to do is basically moving these until we find the right amount. That should be 71.9. So you go into mesh and you can create, I will go with icosphere, object, shade, smooth. So we're gonna see your object as if it has been smoothed. You're gonna still see the edges on the sides, but depending on the amount of object and the size of the object, you will not notice too much of those. So let's put these, pressing M, new collection, and we call these molecules. So we are going to duplicate this, so Shift D. So we select the object, but we need to convert this into a real object to apply a particle system. Object, convert to mesh. Now I'm gonna show you a nice trick. When you use something quite a lot in Blender, you can set up a quick menu. I am actually converting shapes into mesh and vice versa quite often. So what I'm gonna do now is pressing add to quick favorites. And I do the same with the first one. How do you access this is a quick, so you press Q and you have it here. As you can see, I have the shade smooth, shade flat, origins, and this one. Second, we go into the particle properties tab and we create a new particle system. We are gonna use hair because it's a lot easier for us to manage them and we don't need them to be really long. This is just a visualization, to be honest. We do two, even less, one, yeah. Segments, 1 and it goes to 2. Now, they will be emitted from the faces. I did different tests, but I think that the faces, even if when you enter in edit mode, the faces of these objects are not so perfect because there are a lot of vertices and stuff like that that you don't really need all those lines. So if you want to be precise, clean them. But in our case, we want to be fast, going into render, and we want to render the hair not as a path but as a collection. It's gonna ask us which collection. We have a collection called molecules. We don't want to see the emitter because the emitter is gonna be our mesh, but the mesh is gonna be just a guide, so we hide the emitter. The other thing we need to test with a little bit more particles, we increase to 5000 and we already have some of them. We need them to be a little bit more random, so we need to increase the randomness, and we need also to increase the scale of our particles. Now, when you increase the scale increases for all of them. We don't want that. We want some of them to be bigger, some of them to be smaller, so we increase the random scale, and in this way we can have some particles that are bigger and some smaller. As you can see, this one becomes really small, so we can use that to focus on how small we want to go. I would increase them again to maybe 10,000. This way we have a decent amount of particles, and in the final render it's gonna look like a DNA strand. Now, we are going to do exactly the same thing on the second DNA strand, and we have our new particle system, and we created the DNA strand. I would like to use different colors for the strand itself and the histones. We can go into molecules and we can duplicate these, so shift, press and duplicate collection. So in this very case we need to assign a particle system to our histones as well. Actually, we can duplicate the particle system we already had, so we select this one, but in this very case we press on this one, new particle system. Remember, this name is the name assigned to the general particle system. It's like the color of your mesh. This one is the name assigned to your the actual particle system, the one that you are using. So this one is the one, this one is the two, and this one can be the third. So these two share the same particle system on the bottom, but you can rename the top ones in different ways. Part of these, see that they are a single long, created by single long faces. We need to subdivide them a little bit more. So we can focus on one of them, the main one, the one on the bottom. We can enter in edit mode, and as you can see, when you enter in edit mode, the particles disappear because you can see them just in object mode and when you render them. And we are going to press Ctrl R to create a loop cut, and with the mouse wheel we increase the loop cuts. So in this way we have more faces. So instead of having one long face, we have multiple faces. And if we go here, as you can see, the particles are assigned in a better way. So first thing first, we need to separate the screen. Now, one of the things, a lot of people will say, yeah, but you have the shading editor up here. Yes, but I am nostalgic and I like the way Blender was when it was 2.7. So what I'm gonna do is creating a new window, dragging the corner, the top right corner, and changing this into the shader editor. Then I go into the material property and I create a new material. Let's go into viewport shading so we can see the color, and we need to assign a color. So hex code and bam, instead of 0.5 they are gonna be 0.8. I activate ambient occlusion because I want to see the small shadow between the particles. I activate bloom. Print space reflection is, it can be useful. We need to change the color of the other particles. We copied the molecule material, but we need to make a second material. And as you can see, also the particles in here have been updated. I can actually hide these. So what I need to do now is link my whole object to a null object. Add empty, in this case, sphere. And I select everything from main and controllers. And finally, I select the rotator one. So I press Ctrl P to set parent 2 and I do keep transformation. So now if I select this one, I can move all the whole object with me. Now it's time to lit our object, because if we go into render mode, there is no light. We go into the world properties and under color, we set environment texture. So this is gonna create a sphere with a texture wrap around in the inside of the sphere, and it's gonna lit our scene using this texture. So environment texture, and you have a menu here. And if you open the image, of course, I already used one before, you can select an HDR image. So there is a website that's great and offers free HDR images to his users. That's called HDR Heaven. I'm gonna put the link on this video. I already put the link on my other videos, but it's a great resource and I really suggest you to use it. I think that this abandoned hole will make tricks, so I am going to select this texture, as if I go into render you will see that our DNA strand is rendered using this light. So all the shadows and the lights come from our scene. I don't really want to see the building, there is no point for this project, so we are gonna just use the light information without the building itself. This is something that I have shown in a previous tutorial, so I don't over-explain again. I simply do it. We create a second null object, so A, and we create this inside of rotators. So A, rotators. A, and we create an empty, in this case, cube. So we select the sphere and then the cube, and we Ctrl P and we parent them. Remember that it was like around 49 degrees. Go to the camera and it's right. What happens is that now if I select the rotator, so the cube is the rotator 2. The one that controls the rotation of the whole thing. But if I select the one inside of the cube, that's the sphere. If I select here, you're gonna see that the sphere is selected. What I can do is rotate the sphere along the Z axis, and you will see these rotating because the Z axis of the sphere is still the one that points up, even if you rotated it. Now, if I start my animation, the rotation is constant. We can press I on the final frame, selecting the camera, and we put a location. Then we go to the first frame, and having the camera selected, we press G. So we grab the camera, even if we are inside of it. And then X, because we want to move on the X axis. And we go away from these. and we press I location. So now if we start the animation, we can see our DNA strand rotating. If I shift D my DNA strand and then I select the cube that still controls everything, I can actually enter the camera and I can, for example, G this DNA strand and then rotate it like this. So I duplicated multiple times my particle systems. And now we need to add the last touch, the depth of field for our camera. To add the depth of field, we need to be into a mode that allows us to use the depth of field. So the viewport shading should be enough. Otherwise, we can go directly into the render view. We go into the camera tab and we add a depth of field. What we want to do is making sure that first you can see your camera. We make the camera like 5 meters big. We activate the limits of our camera. So this cross is basically our depth of field. Set the focus distance like here. Then we enter in the camera view. We go into viewport display and we decrease the f-stop. In this way you will see that the background becomes over and over blurred. We set up everything for our camera. First thing, we go into the output properties and we select a place where to output. In this very case, I will go into my desktop. I have my YouTube tutorials and I go into, I create a new folder and I call this frames because we're gonna render it frame by frame. The reason is if you render a scene that's so huge, the risk is that your system or your Blender crashes. And if it does while you render 200 frames, we don't arrive to 200 here, no. Let's say that you are at 93 frames, you are going to regret because you cannot re-render a video. I mean, you can re-render from the beginning, but you lose whatever you rendered so far. So what we're gonna do is creating a video frame by frame that's gonna be mounted in Blender or even in another application. Just importing a render sequence. So we set up an output folder and we give a name to the first frame of our scene. It's gonna be DNA maybe. And then we accept. So after that, we set a file format, OpenEXR. In the end, I decided to change the color of the background because I thought that it worked better with a brighter white. Okay. For today, it's everything. I hope that you enjoyed my tutorial. Please subscribe to my channel if you didn't do yet. For now, it's everything, and I will see you next week. Bye!